The theme for today is the evidences confirming the conquering of the challenges of the cross. So again, I read, the evidences confirming conquering the challenges of the cross. So we'll begin our service by doing the consecration and opening hymn done by the praise team, which will be followed by the opening prayer by Brother Robert Harris, and then the scripture reading, which will be done by me.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. This morning, I want you to reflect with me as we look at the finished work of Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary. You see, the cross separated us from God. The cross separated us, and because of that reason, Christ had to come to die for our sins. We were dead in our trespasses and sin, but God commended his love towards us that while we were yet sinners, he sent his only begotten son to die for our sins. Hallelujah. So we have much to give God thanks for this morning. Hallelujah. There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's vein, and sinners plunged beneath that flood lose all their guilty stain. Join your hearts and voices with me as we enter into a time of consecration this morning. Amen. Hallelujah. There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's vein, and sinners plunged beneath that flood. See you.
Today we thank you, Lord, that you have brought us here another day, another time to worship your name. Just join me now as I go to the throne of grace. Hallelujah. In the cross be my glory ever, till my raptured soul shall find sweet rest beyond the river. Near the cross, a trembling soul, 'twas love and mercy that brought me, and helped me walk from day to day with its scenes before me. Near the cross, a trembling soul, love and mercy found me. There the bright and morning star shed its beams around me, helped me walk from day to day. Lord, we thank you another time for your cross. We thank you for, Lord, the cross that the Son of God bore. We thank you, Lord, that he was willing to take up, Lord, the challenge, take up, Lord, what you have designated to him, Lord, that he should bear the cross. Oh God, that he was willing, Lord, to bear, oh God, the burden of our sins. Lord, the cross is not just, Lord, oh, a symbol, but it is, oh God, the way in which you have expressed your love to us, God. The extremity of the way that you wish to go. We thank you, Lord, that the cross, oh God, brings us back memory, oh God, of your divine, oh God, love that you have given to us, God. Lord, we thank you, Lord, that you did not call 10,000 angels to take you down from the cross and set you free. But, Lord, you went on the cross. You bear, oh God, the burdens. Lord, you had your hands pierced. You had your head, oh God, pierced. You had your side pierced and your feet. Oh God, we thank you that you have bear, oh God, and you have overcome the cross, and you have offered up your life for us, God. And Lord, we thank you, Lord, that it was love that, oh God, place you or keep you on that cross. And we thank you, Lord, that there is none like unto thee. Oh God, there are other cross, oh God, on that hill. But Lord, your cross is the right cross, because your cross span the time. Your cross bring back, Lord, you man, oh God, to God. You spanned the gap that was needed, for man was lost. And we thank you, God, that, oh God, your cross is still relevant in this time. Your cross, God, is still relevant. And Lord God, we pray that you'll help us, Lord, to bring our own cross. And we know, God, that you are living because you have overcome the cross. And you are available to help us with our own cross. And so, Lord, we lay our burden down at your cross. And we say thanks, God, for what you have done for us. And we bless and we magnify your name. Lord, I pray right now, God, that somebody listening, Lord, across this world, oh God, that they will come to the acknowledgement of your cross. I pray, God, that everything that will be done this morning will be done to the glory and honor of your name, and that the cross, oh God, will be seen, and that the crucified Christ will be seen, oh God, by somebody who doesn't believe. Oh God, we pray that faith will come alive through the shed blood on the cross. We pray, God, that hope and joy will, oh God, fill somebody's soul. Lord God, that an unsaved, oh God, a desperate person, misguided and full of, oh God, no hope. Lord God, that they might come to you today. Bless the speaker, Lord, through the blood of the cross. Bless, Lord God, the moderator. Bless, God, everything that will be said and done. Let it be done for your glory and your honor. And we tell you thanks in Jesus Christ's name. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. The scripture reading is taken from 1 Corinthians 15, verses 1 to 20. Again, 1 Corinthians 15, verses 1 to 20. And it reads, "Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also ye have received, and wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures, and that he was seen of Cephas, then of the 12. After that, he was seen of above 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain until this present, but some are fallen asleep. After that, he was seen of James, then of all the apostles, and last of all, he was seen of me also, as one born out of due time. For I am the least of the apostles, that am not meet to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and by his grace, which was bestowed upon me, was not in vain. But I labored more abundantly than they all, yet not I, but the grace of God which was with me. Therefore, whether it were I or they, so we preach, and so ye believed. Now if Christ be preached that he rose from the dead, how say some among you that there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there is no resurrection of the dead, then is Christ not risen? And if Christ be not risen, then is our preaching vain, and your faith is also vain. Yea, and we are found false witnesses of God, because we have testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he raised not up, if so be that the dead rise not. For if the dead rise not, then is Christ not raised? And if Christ be not raised, your faith is vain. Ye are yet in your sins. Then they also which are fallen asleep in Christ are perished. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable. But now is Christ risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that slept. This is a portion of God's holy word. We honor it by saying, thanks be to God. Now we'll have a creative piece by Sister Jadeja James.
Hallelujah. This morning we are grateful to be able to glory in the resurrection. Amen. And so we are celebrating the fact that he arose. He arose, 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 he arose. 1, 2, 3, up from the grave he arose. This your poetry, but this are none of prose. Body never decompose, enemy fall like dominoes. 1, 2, 3, up. Him resurrect. I first me see one man come and conquer death. From my born, I never see that yet. See that yet. See that. See that. See that yet.
But he arose.
He arose. He arose. He arose. He arose. He arose, he arose, he arose, he arose, he arose. 1, 2, 3, up. Picture the crucifix.
Yeah.
Them could no hold him with no 6'6".
Yeah.
Nail his hands and whoop him with a whip just for we. In bear it. 1, 2, 3, up.
Hey.
Redemption. So from hell we get exemption if we serve him as the Lord. Worthy is the Lamb, you're seated on the throne. You're higher than a drone. Yeah. Cause he arose, he arose. He arose, he arose, he arose. He arose, he arose. He arose, he arose, he arose. You have no rival, not a equal. He ma come again and part two at the sequel. No rival, not a equal. He ma come again and part two at the sequel. You have no rival, not a equal. He ma come again and part two at the sequel. Hey. No rival, not a equal. He ma come again and part two. Not a equal, he ma come again and part two are the sequel. No rival, not a equal, he ma come again and part two are the sequel. Because he arose, 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 he arose. So listen, death him conquered that, sin him conquered that, sickness and disease him deal with that. Death him conquered that, sin him conquered that, sickness and disease. And we say death him conquered that, sin him conquered that, sickness and disease. You believe? Death him conquered that, sin him conquered that, sickness and disease. The same one when nail him,
I fi go heal him.
The same one when nail him,
I fi go heal him.
We said the same one when nail him,
I fi go heal him.
The same one when nail him,
I fi go heal him.
Hey, no rival, not a equal. Time I come again and part two, what is equal? No rival, equal again and part two, what is equal?
Have no
again and heart who are deceived. No rival, not another equal. You may come again and heart who are deceived. For he arose, he arose, he arose, he arose, he arose. He arose, 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 have no rival, not another equal. He may come again and part two. What is equal?
Rival,
equal. Come again and part two. What is
equal?
No rival, not another equal. He may come again and part two. What is equal?
Hallelujah.
There is no equal, and there can be no sequel. He arose. He arose. Thank God Almighty. Jesus Christ arose. Brothers and sisters, in this wonderful celebration with our young people who is leading us in worship today, I want to take time out to greet everyone. Our assistant pastor, Javon Blackwood, and the team of young people present, those who are watching via the different platforms today, Facebook, YouTube, Zoom. We ask you to break this celebration for a time of reflecting and celebrating a life well lived. So we're asking that we stand together wherever you are as we remember a dear member of the church, affectionately called Sister Cutie. And I would not want you to lose sight of her commitment, her cooperation, and her love for the service of the Lord Christ. Let me hope that you are able to reflect on this wonderful sister, mother, grandmother, friend, and the list goes on. Sister Cutie. A moment of silence is what we observe beginning now for the next 60 seconds. Thank you so very much. Gone, but certainly will never be forgotten. Sister Cutie, we will meet again in the sweet by and by. By extension, I would like to announce to our Fellowship of Faith that Sister Marcia Bennett, a quiet, attendant to our services, who lived in Clement Scheme, housing scheme, passed on March 30th. You will hear more about her Thanksgiving service. And we continue to remember the family, Lorian, and her sibling, and the children. We ask that we reach out to these two families and pray for them so that they will go through the valley of the shadow of death, knowing Jehovah Adonai Shammah is with them. And they will come out on the other side victorious. God bless you as we continue to worship God in the beauty of holiness. Sister Doreen Wallace.
Now we celebrate God with our giving. The Giver's Creed. Giving is a grace. We seek to excel in this grace as in other graces. We affirm that the tithes belong to God for the work of God. We will not rob God of his tenth. We will stand on promised blessings. We affirm, he that soweth sparingly shall also reap sparingly. He that soweth bountifully shall also reap bountifully. Every man, as he purposes in his heart, let him give not grudgingly, nor of necessity, for God loveth a cheerful giver. In this season, we understand the situation of not being able to come to church to give your tithes and offering. So we are making ourselves available during the week for you to come and give your tithes whenever you feel free. We are open, doors are open, and we are here to assist you.
Hallelujah. Let us give God thanks for the gifts that will come and for the gifts that would have been collected. Praise God. Father, we give you thanks for your faithfulness. We give you thanks, O Lord, for your love, for your kindness, for your grace. O gracious God, you have commanded us to give. And so, Lord, we have obeyed such command. Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus Christ that you will bless us in return. Father, we do know that once we give cheerfully, once we tithe, then certainly God, you will reward us. Father, we know that it is more blessed to give than to receive. So we have obeyed your commands. We have given, O gracious God. We are trusting you, Father, to break generational curses as a result of our gifts. We are trusting you, O gracious God, to open doors in uncommon places as a result of our gifts. We are trusting you, O gracious God, to cause us to live in abundance as a result of our faithfulness and as a result of our gifts. I pray, God, that your name will be praised perpetually as your children continue to give to the glory and honor of your name. Thank you for blessing these gifts, O gracious God. Thank you for blessing your people. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the blessed Holy Spirit, amen and amen.
A fire goes before him and burn up all his enemies. The hills melt like wax at the presence of the Lord. At the presence of the Lord. The Lord reigns. The Lord reigns. The Lord reigns. Let the earth rejoice. Let the earth rejoice. Let the earth rejoice. Let the people be glad. The Lord God reigns. The Lord. O Lord, are exalted over all the earth, over all the earth. The Lord reigns, the Lord reigns, the Lord reigns. Let the earth rejoice, let the earth rejoice, let the earth rejoice, and let the people be glad. The Lord God reigns, the Lord God reigns, our God reigns.
Hallelujah. The Lord God reigns, right? The theme again, the evidences confirming, conquering the challenges of the cross. You are the evidence that the cross is conquered. Your presence here today, the fact that you have salvation, the cross is conquered. And we celebrate that because we have the right to celebrate that God conquered the cross for us. So we'll be having an item in ministering dance from Yonika Reynolds.
By his stripes we are healed. By his nail-pierced hands we're free. By his blood we're washed clean. Now we have the victory. The power of sin is broken. Jesus overcame it all.
Yes, he did.
He has won our freedom.
Jesus has won it all.
His Spirit I will rise from the ashes of defeat. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. In your name I come alive to declare your victories. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. By your Spirit I will rise from the ashes of defeat. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. In your name I come alive to declare your victories. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. Hallelujah. You have won the victory.
Lift up your voice and say,
Hallelujah.
You have
won it all for me.
Death could not,
hold you down.
Alive and well, yes.
You are the Prince of Kings.
And you're seated, yes.
Seated in majesty.
God to speak to us. Send the word that He has for us in this season, in this time. So right now I call the man of God who has availed himself for such a time as this to give us the word from God, straight from God. So we call the Reverend Javon Blackwood right now to avail himself to give you the word. Amen.
You have won the victory.
Lift up your voice and say hallelujah.
You have won it all.
Come on, worship him, worship him, worship him.
Death could not hold you down. Your life and well, yeah, you are the real.
Come on, worship, worship, and worship. You are
the risen King.
Come on, stretch your hands towards heaven. Sing hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You have won the victory.
He has won the victory. We worship you. We hoist you. We Amazing in this place, reflecting on the fact that Jesus Christ conquered the challenges of the cross. Death could not hold him down. He is undeniably the risen King. Hallelujah. And therefore today we come to declare the evidences of conquering the challenges of the cross. The evidences confirming conquering the challenges of the cross. Hallelujah. And the basic evidence is that he lives in our hearts. And we are celebrating him this morning because he conquered the challenges of the cross. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, we worship you, Lord. We worship you, Lord. For he was wounded for our transgressions, bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And by his stripes, we are healed. By his stripes, we are healed. By his stripes, we are healed. We give him glory. We give him honor. We are forever indebted to him because he paid it all for us. Hallelujah. The evidences confirming conquering the challenges of the cross. My sisters and brothers, I greet you well. In the matchless name of Jesus Christ, our soon coming King and Savior, Savior of the world, the one who conquered death. Let me extend greetings to our senior pastor, Bishop Hugh Dixon, as well as his family. Let me greet the council members who would have perhaps joined in via Zoom. Let me recognize the youth board. Let me recognize the participants for today's awesome program. May the blessings of the Lord continue to be upon you. Let me recognize the camera crew, technicians, musicians, and just about everyone who would have joined in, the persons who would have tuned in via Facebook, Zoom, YouTube, and Instagram, if I'm correct. I greet you well in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. I greet you in the all-powerful name of Jesus Christ, the conquering King, the one who reigns supremely, the one who we serve, the one who is alive and well, the one who conquered the challenges of the cross. Hallelujah. 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 We worship him because he is worthy to be praised and to be glorified. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The word of the Lord to our hearts this morning comes to us from the passage of scripture that was read. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, reading from verse 1 through to 10. That's 1 Corinthians chapter 15, reading from verse 1 through to 10. I'll be reading from the King James Version. Hallelujah. And it reads, praise God.
Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also ye have received, and wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I have also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures, and that he was seen of Cephas, then of the 12. After that he was seen of above 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain unto this present, but some are fallen asleep. After that he was seen of James, then of all the apostles, and last of all he was seen of me also, as of one born out of due time. Let me reread verse 8. And last of all he was seen of me also, as of one born out of due time. For I am the least of the apostles, that I am not meet to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God I am what I am. And his grace which was bestowed upon me was not in vain, but I labored more abundantly than they all. Yet not I, but the grace of God which was with me. I'm going to read from verse 8 through to 10. And it reads, and last of all, he was seen of me also, as of one born out of due time. For I am the least of the apostles, that I am not meet to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace, which was bestowed upon me, was not in vain, but I labored more abundantly than they all. Yet not I, but the grace of God, which was with me. We give honor to the reading of God's word by saying amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Could someone type out 1 Corinthians 15 verses 1 through to 10 in the chat, so that the believers will be reminded as to where the passage of scripture was taken from. Glory to God. I want to speak to you this morning from the subject, let the biblical evidences speak. Jesus is risen. Let the biblical evidences speak. Jesus is risen. I ask someone to type that out in the chat as well. Let the biblical evidences speak. Jesus is risen. Let us pray. Father, we exalt you. We lift you up this morning, O God, as our King, as our Savior, as our Lord. Father, we are grateful for the fact that you've considered us as your children. Lord, we are in your presence to worship you, to lift you up, to exalt you, Lord. I pray, God, that you will consecrate us now as we avail ourselves to be used by you. Oh God, I pray that you will anoint the ears of the listeners, and that, God, they will have receptive hearts to your word. I pray in the name of Jesus Christ that this congregation will not see me, but they will see Jesus. I pray, God, that you will hide me behind the cross, and that at the end of the day, Lord, your name will be glorified. Your people will be edified. The kingdom of darkness will be terrified. Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus Christ that you will speak to the hearts of your children. I pray, gracious God, that those who are burdened will certainly be encouraged by your word. I pray that your word will go forth with power and with clarity. I pray that my mind right now will be consecrated by your spirit, that that which comes out of my mouth will be sanctioned by the Holy Ghost. Lord, I pray that the atmospheres that your children would have joined in from will be transformed right now by your power and by your spirit. I pray in the name of Jesus Christ that hearts will be spoken to. I pray in the name of Jesus Christ that sinners will turn to you as a result of the proclaimed word. I pray in the name of Jesus Christ that your name, Lord, will be glorified, will be praised, will be honored. We ask all of these in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And amen. And amen. Glory to God. Let the biblical evidences speak. Jesus is risen. Let the biblical evidences speak. Jesus is risen. Hallelujah. 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 Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Now, my beloved brothers and sisters, the arm of theology that deals with the birth, death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ is called Christology. Christology simply means the study of Christ and the events that surround his life and ministry while he was on earth. Now, the word resurrection in the Greek language carries the idea of to stand or to be up again. So the resurrection of Jesus Christ simply means that he is up again after he experienced death. Hallelujah. The resurrection of Jesus Christ speaks to the reality that Christ, after being crucified and buried, snatched the sting out of death and declared, "O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory?" Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Don't leave me, live audience. Stay with me. Hallelujah. Therefore, God has sent me here to remind the body of Christ, or to inform those who are unaware, that our conquering King is not locked away in the tomb. He is not wrapped in grave clothing. He is not being eaten by maggots. His body is not stolen by the disciples. Hallelujah. The seal of the stone did not stop him, but he is risen. Let the biblical evidences speak. He is risen. Hallelujah. A king who is stronger than death. A king who is mightier than death. A king who could not have been contained by the tomb. A king who could not have been contained by the grave clothing. A king who conquered death through the power of God. A king who is seated at the right hand of the Father. A king who is making intercession on the behalf of the redeemed. A king who lives in our hearts. His name is Jesus Christ. He is alive and well. So let the biblical evidences speak. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, praise God, praise God, praise God, praise God. It is critical then to note that the resurrection of Jesus Christ is essential to the ecclesia for several reasons. Firstly, the resurrection shows forth the immense power of God. Thus, to believe in the resurrection is to believe in God himself. Hallelujah. Secondly, it proves that God, hallelujah, it proves that God has the power to raise the dead. And in resurrecting Jesus from the grave, God reminds us of his absolute sovereignty over life and death. Jesus Christ declared in John 11, I am the resurrection and the life. Hallelujah. So it simply means, therefore, that God has the power to call that which is dead back to life. We serve a God who has the power to call that which was dead back to life. We serve a God who has the power to breathe the breath of life into a dead situation. And as a result of such situation comes back to life, comes back to life. I am the resurrection and the life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thirdly, the resurrection allows us to understand that Jesus Christ is the Savior of the world. Hallelujah. Fourthly, the resurrection is the triumphant and glorious victory for every believer. In other words, the believer is already living a victorious life because Christ has purchased it through his resurrection. I can acclaim victory as a believer of Jesus Christ because Jesus Christ would have conquered the challenges of the cross. I can declare myself to be victorious because Jesus Christ conquered rejection. Jesus Christ conquered humiliation. Jesus Christ conquered condemnation. Therefore, the Apostle Paul was able to declare in Romans 8 verse 1, there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus. He conquered condemnation. He conquered rejection. He conquered humiliation. He was wounded. Hallelujah. Therefore, let the biblical evidences speak. He is risen. The Savior of the world is not locked away in a tomb. The Savior of the world was not stolen by the disciples. The Savior of the world was not eaten by maggots. The Savior of the world could not have been contained by a tomb that was made with male hands, that was made with human hands. But early Sunday morning, he got up and he said, oh death, where is thy sting? Oh grave, where is thy victory? Over the ages, the thought he could have conquered the believers of Jesus Christ. Isaiah was the eagle's eyes prophet. He had a prophetic eye that was beyond the ordinary. Yet he died and was not resurrected. Oh, praise the name of the Lord. Ezekiel was a powerful prophet. He died, but he did not receive the resurrection. Ah, my God, my God. The Apostle Paul, though he was powerful, he died and he's still dead. Peter was powerful. Peter was anointed. He died and he is still dead. I wonder if the church is with me. Ah! Noah walked with God. He was anointed, powerful, sold out. He died. He is still dead. Ah, Jesus. Ah, Lord. Flavius Josephus, a brilliant historian, he died, he is still dead. But I stop by to tell you something, that the Savior of the hung it down. And he said before, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they have done. Afterwards, he declared in the biblical Greek, tetelestai. In other words, it is finished. Redemption is paid for. He died. Oh, hell had a party, thought that Christ was not going to be raised again. So hell was celebrating all day on Saturday. The devil was saying, we have finally got him. The devil was saying, the sting of death has finally reached him. The devil was saying, he is finally controlled and contained by us. But early Sunday morning, resurrection power arose from his spirit. The grave could not contain him. The sealed tomb could not hold him. He got up with all power and declared, oh death, where is thy sting? You stung Elijah. Amakoshatura. You stung Isaiah. But you can't hold me. I came to die. I came to conquer the challenges of the cross. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Death had a party all day Saturday. Death was just laughing, saying, he said he's the resurrection and the life. So let us see. But early Sunday morning, when death discovered that it had no more power, death allowed the chief priests and the elders to come up with an idea to say that the body was stolen. But it was too late, because Mary Magdalene had already seen him. It was too late, because the tomb was already empty. It was too late, because the napkin was nicely folded, which connotated that I will return. I will come back for my church. In the Jewish culture, when someone would eat, they would fold the napkin a particular way. And that kind of message is that I enjoyed this meal and I will return to your household pretty soon. So when Christ got up Sunday morning, there was a napkin that they placed over his face. But when he arose, he folded that napkin, left it right there on the bed that they laid him. What was he saying to the church? I am coming back. I am going to return for the redeemed. Let the redeemed of the Lord shout that he is risen. He is risen. He is alive and well. Hallelujah. In an article by the prolific Jack Zavada, 7 critical proofs or evidences of Jesus' resurrection are shared. And I would like to share them with you this morning. Firstly, Zavada mentioned the empty tomb. Praise God. Secondly, he noted the eyewitnesses of the holy women, such as Mary, the mother of James, Mary, the mother of Jesus, Mary Magdalene, and other women. Hallelujah to God. Thirdly, he highlighted the newfound courage of the apostles. that these guys, these men, were cowards. But after Jesus' resurrection, they were ready to die on his behalf. Why? Because they had seen that Jesus Christ was risen. Fourthly, he shared about the changed lives of James and other followers of Jesus Christ. Fifthly, the large crowd of more than 500 eyewitnesses was mentioned. Sixthly, the martyrs of Jesus Christ. And seventhly, the conversion of Paul. So these are seven biblical evidences that would show us clearly that Christ is risen. Let me go over them again for your benefit. He mentioned the empty tomb, and that is the most potent of the evidences. He mentioned the eyewitnesses of the holy women, such as Mary, the mother of James, Mary, the mother of Jesus, Mary Magdalene, and the list goes on. He highlighted the newfound courage of the apostles. Fourthly, he shared about the changed lives of James and other followers of Jesus Christ. Fifthly, the large crowd of more than 500 eyewitnesses was mentioned. Sixthly, the martyrs of Jesus Christ. And seventhly, the conversion of the Apostle Paul. Furthermore, it is noteworthy that the scripture under scrutiny, which is 1 Corinthians chapter 15, is a potent portion of scripture that allows us to understand clearly that Jesus Christ is risen. Hallelujah. The book of 1 Corinthians was written by the Apostle Paul, the same Paul whose conversion was mentioned above. Now listen to me, beloved saints. Based on historical and biblical records, he founded the church in Corinth. Hallelujah. It is believed that after leaving the church for a few years, the apostle heard some disturbing reports about the church. He heard that they were full of pride and were involved in sexual immorality. In addition, he heard that spiritual gifts were being used improperly, and that they misunderstood important Christian doctrines. Now, the book of Ecclesiastes allows us to understand that there is nothing new under the sun. And I know that there are many persons out there who are questioning the resurrection. There are many persons out there who are saying, well, that's just a figment of y'all's imagination. Oh, that's not true. You all were hallucinated. In fact, there are many theories out there as to what would have transpired. There is the theory of hallucination, that these persons were hallucinated. But how on God's earth could 500 persons, over 500 persons, be drunken at the same time? Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Hallelujah to God. So one of these doctrines was the resurrection of the body. So the Corinthians, they didn't understand the resurrection of the body. So because of this, the Apostle Paul saw it fit to coin a particular portion of scripture that would refute or that would assist them in understanding the doctrine of resurrection. The Apostle Paul wrote about the resurrection of Christ in defense of the fact that Jesus Christ was truly resurrected and it was not a myth. In other words, the Apostle Paul was saying to the believers in Corinth, let the biblical evidences speak. Jesus is risen. Therefore, I am of the persuasion that as believers, we do not need to contend with scoffers, pessimists, doubters, agnostics, and cynics about the resurrection of Jesus Christ. There are so many records in the book that supports the fact that Jesus Christ is risen. The book says it. Therefore, it's a fact. Hallelujah. The Apostle Paul, in his efforts, to defend the resurrection, raised the bishop some solid evidences about the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That will form the substratum of our exploration this morning. Shall we delve in? Now, the first account that proves that Jesus was certainly risen from the dead is the account of the scriptures. Now turn over to 1 Corinthians for me. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. I know that we read it earlier, but sometimes when you're listening to the preacher, you lock the Bible, you close the Bible. So turn to 1 Corinthians 15 for me and look at verse 3 so that you'll know that Reverend Blackwood is not telling you something from his head, but it is grounded in the word of God. Now the first evidence that Jesus Christ is risen is the account of the scriptures. The text says, "For I delivered unto you first of all that which I have also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to what? The scriptures. And that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to what? The scriptures." Now that tells us that the evidence is present in the word of God. Let's go. Now in the biblical text before us, we see clearly that Jesus Christ was risen based on the account of the scriptures, as stated by Paul. An account is simply a record. So in essence, the Apostle Paul was saying that the Lord is risen based on the records in the Logos, the word of God, or the scriptures. It must be noted. That the Bible is the inspired word of God. In fact, the first tenet of the declaration of faith of the Church of God is that we believe in the verbal inspiration of the Bible. In other words, men of old, as they wrote the portion of scripture, their intellects were charged by the power of God. And as they moved their fingers, God was just blowing the breath in their intellects. So they didn't write based on their own thinking. They wrote as heaven deposited it. The Apostle Paul, upon explaining this to the church in Corinth, started at the death of Christ. And he says, as seen in the scriptures. Now, before we can get to the resurrection of Jesus Christ, we need to understand his death. And Bishop did a great job at exploring that on Good Friday. It is important to note that the death of Jesus Christ is centered on the gospel. The question then becomes, how did Jesus die? And we know this already, but I'm just providing this information for context's sake. May I submit that the Roman government executed him by one of the cruelest forms of capital punishment known as crucifixion. This form of death intended that the inflictor would die slowly. Furthermore, the apostle went on to say that he died for our sins. In other words, at some point before he died, before the veil of the temple was torn, before he cried a tetelestai, there was an awesome spiritual transaction that took place. God the Father laid upon Jesus Christ all the guilt and wrath of the sins of humanity. So there was a spiritual transaction at the time when it took place. He said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not. What they have done or what they do." But at the same time, when that spiritual transaction took place, Jesus Christ took all the guilt, the wrath that we deserved. And then he said, it is finished. Jesus, the perfect sacrifice, bore it by himself. Thus he became an enemy of God, so that I would have friendship with God. So the Son of God himself became enemy, so that I could be deemed as friend. Isaiah 53 verses 3 through to 5 puts it powerfully. It says, musicians help me, he is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, my God, and we hid as it were our faces from him. He was despised and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. He 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 carried our pain. He carried our rejection. He carried our humiliation. He took them all to the cross. And he said, it is finished. In other words, because I took your place, you will not be controlled by the spirit of rejection. Because I took your place, you will not be controlled by condemnation. Because I took your place, you will not be controlled by humiliation. It is finished. I declare and I decree that it is finished in your life. The pain is finished. The rejection is finished. The heartbreak is finished. Hallelujah to God. Christ declared that it is finished. Therefore, it is finished. It is finished. Somebody type it in the chat. It is finished. Somebody shout it with me. It is finished. It is finished. You don't have to slay no lambs. Oh, God. He is the great I am. It is. Yet we did esteem him stricken. Still going through Isaiah 53 verses 3 through to 5. And afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. Therefore, I celebrate the conquering Christ this morning for the substitutionary death. I celebrate the conquering Christ for the vicarious death. Therefore, I do not need to worry about being rejected, humiliated, or condemned, because he bore them all for me. His place on the cross should have been mine, but he took my place. So I am forever indebted to him. I am forever indebted to him. Romans 5 verse 1 says, therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus. So I do not need to worry about diabetes, because by his stripes or with his stripes I am healed. I do not need to worry about cancer or lupus, because with his stripes I am healed. I do not need to worry about any kind of sickness, because with his stripes I am healed. The Apostle Paul spoke about the burial of Christ. Some persons fail to understand that the burial of Christ is a significant part of the gospel message. Because if he were not buried, we could not claim that he was raised from the dead. Evidence of his burial can be found in John 19 verses 31 through to 37. The death of Christ was confirmed at the cross. His death fulfilled a prophecy given by Isaiah in Isaiah 53 and verse 9. It says, "And he made his grave with the wicked, and the rich in his death, because he had done no violence, neither was any deceit in his mouth." He died and was buried. Everything that happened on the cross was divinely orchestrated. This was not a last-minute plan. From the moment men fell, and God knew that men, God knew that mankind would have fallen. So he already had a plan. The redemptive covenant was already in place. That plan can be deemed as eternal, because if God is eternal, it means that the plan was in place from that time. That God did not come up with a plan when he recognized that men fell. But that plan was already in place. If God is from everlasting to everlasting, Jesus Christ, time cannot contain him. Our limited scope cannot describe it. But it meant that he had a plan. So if God had a plan to redeem humanity, oh, I know he has a plan for me. A plan that he didn't come up with along the way. But before I was formed in my mother's womb, he had a plan. That plan had eternal implications. God is not based in heaven. He's not based in heaven at this time, trying to decide what happens next. God is not based in heaven, trying to decide, wait, what happens tomorrow? Wait, what date is today? What's going to take place tomorrow? Wait, there is a pandemic. What do I do now? No, God is not based in the floor of heaven. Might I testify from the book of Isaiah? Isaiah chapter 6. Glory to the name of the Lord. The nation of Israel was in a chaos because they had lost a king. In the year that King Uzziah died, the nation was chaotic. The nation was confused. The prophet himself was going through a chaotic moment. But that was when he saw the Lord. And listen to what the account says. Isaiah said, "I saw the Lord high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple." Where did he see the Lord? Seated on his throne. He was not pacing the floor. He was not trying to find out what happens next. He was seated like a boss. He was seated on his throne, which meant that he was in control. He understood the future. God is in control. God is in control. He is seated on his throne. He is not pacing the floor of heaven. He is from everlasting to everlasting. So the redemptive covenant was not an afterthought. It was the masterful plan of God. Now it brings me to where I want to go. It says here, according to the Apostle Paul's submission, he rose again on the third day. The phrase "rose again" in the original language speaks to a rose from the sleep of death. Thus, the statement made above, speaks emphatically to the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It is important to note that Jesus made a declaration in Matthew 16 and verse 21 that he would rise in 3 days after his death. And here we see a clear fulfillment of such. It means then that whenever divinity makes a declaration, humanity must await its fulfillment. When divinity makes a declaration, humanity must await its fulfillment. In other words, when the Lord declares something, we must wait on him to see its fulfillment. Why? Because he is not a man that he should lie. Why? He is not slack concerning his promises. As much as he promised his resurrection and it came to pass, we must watch out for his second advent, because he promised it as well. As much as he promised that his Holy Spirit would come, and it came on the day of Pentecost, we must wait on him for the promises that he has made, or that he has given unto us. The promise of wealth, the promise of peace of mind, the promise of joy, the promise of good health, the promise of good success. He is a promise keeper. Jesus Christ said, I will arise in 3 days. Kill this body and you will see it again in 3 days. And you might wonder, okay, he said that he would. But guess what? They could have come up with their own testimonies. They could have concocted their own ideologies about his resurrection. But they couldn't, and I will say this and close, they couldn't. Why? Because early Sunday morning, Mary Magdalene and the group of women, they were journeying to the tomb with the intent of putting spices on his body so that it could not have decayed. But when they reached close, Jesus, the tomb was opened and an angel was there. And the angel said, why seek ye the living? Why seek ye the living among the dead? He is risen. Hallelujah to God. Listen, beloved saints. Sometimes when God gives us a word, we forget it in moments of crisis. God told the disciples, Jesus told the disciples, that he would have risen on the third day. But because they were fearful, they forgot the promise. They were busy trying to take care of his body, but he wasn't there anymore. Why seek ye the living among the dead? My beloved brothers and sisters, I want you to understand that there are some times when God gives us a word, but based on what we are going through, we forget that word. Might I say to you that as God promised it, it will come to fruition. Jesus said, after 3 days, I will be up again. Everything looked impossible. He violated biology. He violated all kinds of things. And he arose up from the grave. He arose. Therefore, we can sing, he lives. He lives. Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and he talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives. He lives. Salvation. You ask me how I know. I know that he lives because he lives within my heart. Might I say to you, beloved brothers and sisters, Jesus is risen according to the scriptures. It is clearly outlined in the word of God. The saints can testify about it. Peter can talk about it. Thomas can tell you about it. And I can tell you about it. How could you tell me about it, preacher? He lives in my heart. If you watch my life, you'll see the risen Lord transforming a young boy out of the hills of St. Elizabeth, Newmarket to be specific, anointed him to preach the gospel. Young, still wet behind the ears, as some would say, but the anointing of God, the Spirit of God, the conquering power of God, the resurrection power of God lives within my heart. I can tell you about it. Give him a chance in your life. What's his name? 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 Somebody shout Jesus. Somebody shout Jesus. Somebody shout Jesus. In Matthew, he is deemed as the Messiah. In Mark, he is the wonder worker. In Luke, he is the Son of Man. In John, he is the Son of God. He is the Word. In the Acts, he is the foundation of the church. In Romans, he is our justifier. In 1st and 2nd Corinthians, he is our sanctifier. In Galatians, he is the redeemer from the curse of the law. In Ephesians, he is the Christ with unsearchable riches. He lives within my heart. Jesus Christ is risen according to the scriptures. Praise God. I would have provided 7 evidences according to Jack, great biblicist. Let me reread them, then I'll close. The empty tomb, the eyewitnesses of the holy women, such as Mary, the mother of James, Mary, the mother of Jesus, Mary Magdalene, and the list goes on. The newfound courage of the apostles, the changed lives of James and other followers of Jesus Christ, the large crowd of more than 500 eyewitnesses, the martyrs of Jesus Christ, and seventhly, the conversion of the apostle Paul. Of course, in the particular scripture that was read, 1 Corinthians, verses 1 through to 10, we see the account of the scriptures in verses 3 through to 4. And I trust that someday I'll be able to preach the entirety of the sermon. We also see the account of the saints in verses 5 through to 6. Rather, in verses 5 through to 7. And it reads, and he was seen of Cephas. Cephas meaning Peter. Then of the 12. And after that he was seen of above 500 brethren at once. Now it means that there was an account from the saints because they saw him. So not only do we see the account of the scriptures, we see the account of the saints. And we also see the account of the subordinate. What do you mean by that, Rev? We see the account of the subordinate in verses 8 through to 9. And it reads, and last of all, he was seen of me also, as of one born out of due time. For I am the least of the apostles. Right there, the apostle Paul deemed himself as a subordinate. Therefore, we have biblical evidences to show that Jesus Christ is risen because of the account of the scriptures. It's clearly shown in the Bible, the account of the saints. Peter can testify. Hallelujah. Paul can testify. Thomas can testify. The over 500 witnesses can testify. And we also have the account of the subordinate, the Apostle Paul, who said, I am the least of the apostles. Our King is risen. Hallelujah. If you're on this platform and you're not saved, I want to make an invitation to you this morning. I want to tell you about the Savior of the world, the one who lives, the one who reigns, the one who is in control of your life. That based on the account of the scriptures, we can say that he is risen. Based on the account of the saints, we can say that he is risen. And based on the account of the subordinate, we can say that he is risen. Give him a chance in your life today, because he lives. And certainly, he is returning for his church. And you must be with us, the believers of Jesus Christ, when the saints go marching in. I pray that you will give Jesus Christ a chance in your life today. For the believers, I want to say to you that you can stand and declare boldly that your Savior is risen based on the account of the scriptures, the account of the saints, and the account of the subordinate. Hallelujah. He lives. Oh yes, oh yes, oh yes.
He walks with me and he talks.
He talks with me
along life's narrow way. He lives. He lives. Salvation to
sovereign God, we thank you for today. We thank you for the evidences, the biblical evidences that you would have presented to us, O God, that would have clearly shown us that Christ Jesus lives today. Lord, we give you thanks for the account of the scriptures. We give you thanks, O gracious God, for the account of the saints. We give you thanks for the account of the subordinate, the Apostle Paul himself. I pray in the name of Jesus Christ that your children will live with the certainty that Christ Jesus lives and that he reigns forever and that he's making intercession on their behalf. Oh God of heaven, I pray that you will touch your children. For those who would have decided to give you a chance in their lives, I pray, God, that you will present yourself, Jesus Christ, to them, and that clearly they'll be spoken to, and that they will be ministered to profoundly and significantly. We give you thanks for the fact that we can testify that you live today. We have experienced you. You live within our hearts. And we can say, we know, Ashora Hatera Handai. We know, Makodobosura Handiketia. We know that you live because you live within our hearts. We thank you, Lord, for speaking to us. We thank you for coming nigh. We give you praise, glory, and honor. Because Jesus Christ lives today. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Oh, God Almighty. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future. My life is worth while living just because he lives. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Could we sing that? Hallelujah. Because he lives, I can face.
Because he lives.
Hallelujah.
I can face tomorrow. Because he lives.
All fear.
Because I love.
God. There goes the evidences confirming, conquering the challenges of the cross. Jesus Christ conquered rejection. He conquered humiliation. And he conquered condemnation. Praise the name of the Lord. And we have the evidences in Scripture that he is risen. Mary Magdalene can testify. Thomas can testify. Peter can testify. The Apostle Paul can testify. The over 500 saints can testify. Hallelujah. And we're not just talking about an historical presentation, but we have people here who can testify because he lives in our hearts. Hallelujah. I do hope and trust that you will walk and you will stand boldly declaring that I serve a risen King, and the evidences are clear in Scripture. Praise the name of the Lord. Beloved brothers and sisters, thank you very much for tuning in to our Youth Sunday service. Perhaps you're asking or you're wondering, why is it that Youth Sunday is on second Sunday? Might I say to you that we switched with Joshua Ministries because there will be a national or a regional Joshua Ministries event coming up on the fourth Sunday. So we switched with them so that they could accommodate that regional worship experience. Congress is in full swing.
Hallelujah.
It has been a great experience thus far. We will be having the closing ceremony at 3. Praise the Lord. At 3, all are invited to tune in. Seniors are invited to tune in as well. Enjoy the wonderful worship experience. Praise the name of the Lord. Therefore, we will not be having an evening worship experience. The closing ceremony for Congress will definitely be that worship experience for us this evening. Please tune in. Remember the different services for this week. Wednesday, fasting service, Bible study in the evening. And of course, before I say Wednesday, let's go to Tuesday. The teens ministry, of course.
Woo!
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. The teens ministry will be having their fellowship. So please tune into that via Zoom at 7. Wednesday at 10 a.m. fasting service. In the evening, we'll have Bible study at 7. Youth fellowship Friday. Saturday morning, we will have
prayer meeting.
And of course, Sunday morning again, we will have our powerful worship experience.
Hallelujah.
Because he lives, certainly we can face tomorrow. May the blessings of the Lord be with you as you go throughout the rest of your day. And of course, as you encounter the week. Well, the week has already started. So as you go through, or as you go throughout this week, praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Let us pronounce the benediction together. Hallelujah. Then the praise team is going to take us out in a powerful way. Hallelujah. And now may the saving grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, the full fellowship of the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, rest, remain, and abide with us all, now and forevermore. God's people say,
amen.
Someone just type it in the chat. Amen.
Amen.
Type it in the chat. He lives.
He lives.
There are biblical evidences to support that he lives. Please remember to pray for the bereaved. Remember those persons who are grieving at this time. Lift them up to God as the conquering King offers comfort to them. May the peace of God be with you, beloved saints. He lives. Bless your heart. Praise thee.
I can face.